On March 29, 1983, Warren and I departed Vancouver on our way to Japan. My romanticized image of Japan had been influenced by the beautiful woodblock prints of kimono-clad women, and I really half expected to find exactly this kind of beauty everywhere. We arrived in Tokyo, Japan's huge capital, and we left our hotel to find ourselves in the middle of a big, noisy, incredibly crowded modern city. If you looked around, you could still see remnants of the old Japan. Most kimono that we saw, however, were being worn by older women, the younger generation having adopted Western dress, except for special occasions. We stayed at the Marunouchi Hotel, a North American or Western-style hotel. We also stayed in some Japanese-style inns, complete with sliding paper doors, when you sleep on futons spread out on the floor, and kneel on cushions. The Tokyo subway map is pretty challenging, especially since we couldn't read most of the signs, but we managed remarkably well. Our first mission was shopping in the Ginza district of Tokyo, a trendy commercial area of the city filled with exclusive shops, many with Paris high fashions, lots of restaurants, coffee houses, and nightclubs. But perhaps our favorite spot for shopping was Takashimaya department store. The staff-to-customer ratio seemed remarkably close to 1-to-1. There were young hostesses whose only job was to bow to passengers entering and leaving the elevators. And all the employees are continually bowing and talking, seemingly to no one in particular, welcoming you to the store with the word "Irashaimasu." We were there in April, and all the stores had special displays of paraphernalia that families buy for a boys' festival on May 5th. These consist of displays of feudal armor, swords, helmets, and banners. The carp is one of the symbols of the Boys' Day Festival, because, like the salmon, the carp swims upstream and thus is an example of the virtues of strength, ambition, and perseverance. Besides the department stores, we saw many small merchant stalls on the sidewalks of Tokyo, like this fish market. Sometimes you had to look twice, though, to see if you were looking at real food or at fake food. Most restaurants display wax or plastic facsimiles of the items on their menu in display cases out on the sidewalk. Asakusa is a district of Tokyo that manages to retain the feel of old Japan. This huge paper lantern hangs in the gateway to the Asakusa Kwannon Temple, and at the end of a street that's lined with little shops, mostly filled with tourist junk, but some with beautiful traditional arts and crafts as well. Asakusa, like most of Tokyo, was badly bombed during World War II, but unlike other parts of the city, Asakusa was rebuilt in wood instead of concrete to retain the flavor of old Japan. The main temple at Asakusa is surrounded by a grove of cherry trees, and when the trees aren't naturally in bloom, thousands of these plastic cherry blossoms are wired individually to the branches of the trees. In a few weeks, the real blossoms would be out. The Imperial Palace, the residence of the Emperor of Japan, is only open to the public twice a year, and even then only a limited part of the grounds is accessible. But surrounded by a moat filled with carp, even the Imperial Palace outer walls are very impressive. Our first expedition out of Tokyo was to Kamakura. In the 12th century, the first military government was established with the shogun, or barbarian conquering supreme general, at its head. The very first shogun set up court at Kamakura, and so the city became quite important, and many fine temples and buildings were constructed here. Also at Kamakura is the Daibutsu, or Great Buddha, the second largest Buddha in Japan. The Daibutsu was once housed in a huge temple, but a tidal wave back in 1495 washed away the building, and it was never rebuilt. The castle city of Nagoya was our next stop. Most of our traveling was on the super fast and super efficient bullet trains that can travel over 200 kilometers an hour. The real-life military leader on which the book and television movie Shogun were based was Ieyasu Tokugawa. He was the first of a long line of Tokugawa shoguns, and this castle at Nagoya was the Tokugawa family residence for two centuries, up until 1868, when the emperor abolished the shogunate. Perhaps the most beautiful spot we visited in Japan was Ise, located in a national park. For followers of the Shinto religion, Ise is the most sacred place in all Japan. The architecture at Ise is the simplest and oldest style of Shinto shrine, purely Japanese without any kind of Chinese influence. The buildings are constructed of cypress wood, completely without the use of dowels or nails. Purification is an important ritual in Shintoism. At the entrance to every shrine, there is always a well or basin at which one can purify himself by washing with and drinking sacred water. In very early times, when an emperor died, his palace and his whole capital city were completely abandoned because they had been defiled by death. Early Japanese buildings, even important ones, were never designed to be permanent. In fact, as a symbol of renewal and rebirth, all these buildings at Ise are completely dismantled and rebuilt every 20 years on a nearby site. To add to the ancient mood at Ise, we heard the chanting of no-drama songs to the accompaniment of flute and drums in the distance, and we followed the sound and watched a portion of a traditional Japanese no-drama being performed on an outdoor stage. Kyoto, our next stop, was the capital of Japan from the 8th century up until 1868, when the Emperor Meiji abolished the shogunate and moved his capital to Tokyo. The Heian Shrine in Kyoto is a replica, on a smaller scale, of what the original imperial palace would have looked like when the capital was founded there in 794 AD. The main attraction at Heian Shrine, though, is its beautiful garden, famous for its dazzling springtime display of cherry blossoms. One of the most impressive sights in Kyoto is Nijo Castle, the palace and residence of Tokugawa Ieyasu, the shogun I told you about earlier. This is the elaborate inner gate. The garden at Nijo is beautiful. It is said that it was originally made without any trees because the sight of falling leaves reminded the shogun of death. Ordinary people like us rarely get to see geisha. They are very expensive entertainers who sing and dance in intimate restaurants or private homes. However, occasionally you can see a geisha, or a maiko, an apprenticed geisha, standing on the street corner or going from one appointment to another. For 111 years now, every April, the geisha of Kyoto do put on public performances. Morning, morning. to a district of Kyoto renowned for its cherry blossoms. Cherry blossom viewing is quite a cult in Japan. People go in hordes to admire the blossoms at their peak. We're still in Kyoto, now at the Kinkakuji, or Golden Pavilion. The Golden Pavilion was built in 1397 as the Shogun Yoshimitsu's villa, and it's called the Golden Pavilion because the upper stories are covered in gold foil. It was the Shogun's wish that the villa become a Zen temple after his death. In 1950, an arsonist destroyed the pavilion. In fact, a novel and a motion picture were made about the crime. The pavilion was rebuilt in 1955. In another corner of Kyoto, we find the Silver Pavilion, built by Yoshimasa, the grandson of Yoshimitsu, the builder of the Gold Pavilion. It was constructed at a time when the Shogun's power was declining, and although it was his intention to cover the outside with silver foil, this was never done. The refined tea ceremony rituals were formulated here in this very building. Moon viewing was another aesthetic pastime enthusiastically pursued by Yoshimasa, and this smooth cone of sand in the courtyard is admired for its ability to reflect moonlight. One of the most visited spots in Kyoto by Japanese and foreigners is Ryoanji Temple. The grounds are beautiful, but what has drawn visitors for centuries is the dry Zen garden. Many Zen temples are widely known for their small dry gardens, which are constructed mainly of sand and rocks with a minimum of greenery. 15 rocks at the Ryoanji Garden, which are arranged in 5 groups, are buried deep under the ground, exposing only their tips like icebergs. The massive stability of the rocks and the absence of any vegetation except for the ancient moss that has grown around the rocks hint at man's quest for timelessness and unchangeability. These rock gardens are meant not to be walked in, but to be viewed from a single fixed point, as though they were paintings or sculptures. And interestingly, this garden has been designed so that at no spot around its edge can one see all 15 rocks at once. There's always at least one partially hidden by the other rocks. There has been a castle at Himeji since the 14th century. We went there because the present castle, dating from the 17th century, is the only authentically old castle in the country, having escaped fire and war over the centuries. The Japanese called this castle the White Crane because the graceful curve of the roofs and the pure white walls remind them of a crane about to soar into flight. The furthest west we traveled was to the sacred island of Miyajima near Hiroshima. The mists that accompanied our ferry boat ride to the island seemed appropriate for a location so sacred that births and deaths are forbidden to take place there. When the tide is out, one can walk along the beach at the foot of the sea wall. One of Japan's most famous tourist sites is located there, the O-Tori, or Great Vermilion Gate, which marks the entrance to the Shinto shrine here. When the tide is in, the Tori Gate is surrounded by water. The world's oldest snow stage is located here at Miyajima. Throughout Japan, you often see these strips of paper tied to tree branches. They're horoscopes. Once you've read them, you tie them to a tree, usually on the precincts of a shrine or a temple. Osaka is only 20 minutes by bullet train from Kyoto. We went there because of its castle, and because of the classic Bunraku puppet troupe, which makes its home here. The puppets are one half life size, and the main characters are operated by 3 puppeteers working together. The story is told by a narrator who sits to the side of the stage and passionately relates the usually melodramatic story. In Kyoto, I also attended a no-drama performance. No-drama is the most refined and esoteric classical theatrical form of Japanese drama. It is a subtle and painfully slow-moving theater that features masked and elaborately costumed actors. The main character in a no-drama usually wears a mask, which conveys a sense of mystery and otherworldliness, suggesting only vaguely subtle changes in the emotional state of the characters. Back in Tokyo, Warren and I took in one more kind of traditional Japanese drama, kabuki. Kabuki is very much a people's theater, filled with action and emotion, but again, very stylized. We were fortunate enough to see an actor designated by the government as one of Japan's living national treasures. Utaemon is the foremost onnagata, or portrayer of female roles. All parts are played by men in kabuki theater. Our final day trip was north of Tokyo to Nikko. When the great shogun Ieyasu Tokugawa died, it was his wish to have a mausoleum built at Nikko. Japanese architecture is characteristically simple and undecorated. The buildings at Nikko, however, are noteworthy for their opulent, almost vulgar ornamentation. The day we were there, so were about 3,000 school children on a field trip. So after 4 weeks in Japan, we boarded a plane for Vancouver, bringing back many memories and several suitcases full of stuff. Now I'm just waiting for my chance to go back again. Thanks for letting me share some of my trip with you.